1 Timothy 3:9, if you could, in your Bible. And we're going to hold there, put your finger there, because we're going to go on a little journey together. And then eventually we'll end up at 1 Timothy 3:9. So I'm going to talk to you from 1 Timothy 3:9 today about a verse that is very interesting, and I've been pondering this for about a year. So much so that I've been having the Lord just pour into me. It's called the mystery of the faith. Now, I'm going to make clear right now at the beginning, there's a difference between the ministry of faith, mystery of faith, and the mystery of the faith. I'll clarify that a little more as we go on. But if you can have full attention to the Word of God today, we'll go on a journey today probably you've never been on. And some of you already know these things that I'm going to share. Many of you have had experiences in life where you've understood that God has shrouded himself in mystery. And what the reality is, he's also expressed himself in secret things. So when we look at the very beginning, understanding the mystery of faith, I have to go back all the way to the beginning of the Word of God, to Genesis. Now I'm going to share a few scriptures here, just the first opening verses 1 through 4 of Genesis. But listen very carefully, because all of the major doctrines, the foundation of every major doctrine in the Bible, is found in Genesis. And we were always taught, I'm sure you too, Pastor Shawn, the best commentary on the Bible is the Bible. And the scripture references that we have refers to scripture. Scripture interprets scripture. Not me or Pastor Shawn or Gilbert Colombo. How do you say praise the Lord again?
Les
Ani Padre. Gloria a Dios. Praise the Lord. Love all that. Language speaking in tongues. Watch out, gotta have interpretation. Now, in the beginning, God prepared, I'm going to read it in this version, God prepared, formed, and fashioned, and created the heavens and the earth. First one. Isn't that a wonderful verse? He prepared, that means he had a preparation of before he even made it. He prepared in his mind. God is unfathomable how he did this.
Yes.
But he did it. That's what we just believe. That's part of the mystery of faith, isn't it? And so the next verse is so interesting, because this verse 2 says, this is a different version. I've taken all the Hebrew scholars, translators, different versions, put it in this. This is the Becker version, you can call it, or the heresy version, you can call it that, even to whatever you want. But the earth had become, it says the earth was void, but actually the word the earth had become, it's the pluperfect term, which in English teachers you might remember, Spanish, pluperfect means it had already happened, something had happened before. So you could read it like this, but the earth had become without form, chaos, confused. The word without form really means confused.
Yes.
Now, right away I think of a verse. Is God the author of confusion?
No.
You're with me already, aren't you? So, confused, it was an empty waste and void, and darkness was upon the face of the very great deep. Now the word darkness, in 1 John we're studying the verse that says, in him is no
darkness.
He is light. Now this is before God even said before, he never said yet, let there be light. Listen to this. Darkness is the Hebrew word for the abyss, the final resting place of all the hordes of hell. So what does this all mean? We are told by most scholars, it's been over hundreds of years, decades and decades, verse 2 has been studied and studied and studied, and they don't really know what it all means. Verse 2 is a mystery. How many have ever heard of the gap theory? That there was a gap between verse 1 and verse 2, and it was possibly millions of years, where the earth was pre-inhabited by dinosaurs and scared people and demonic order. Now, if you believe in that, I'm still your friend. And if you believe in this, then we're still friends. We are looking at a mystery, the mystery of creation, right? Is the earth, is it billions of years old or thousands of years old? That's not my main focus in life. My main focus is making it with her and my grandkids and my kids and serving God. But these things are interesting, aren't they? Now listen to this. It says this, that the earth was in darkness and it was upon the face of the very great deep, that is the abyss. Is that in the notes there? And then it says, the abyss became as a result of judgment. So was there judgment in verse 2? Think about it. The earth was void, darkness, confusion. The God I know is light, order, perfection, love. Something happened here. We don't really know everything about it. But according to Scripture, let's work read through the next verse and we see what happens. Then it says, the Spirit of God was moving, hovering, brooding, actually, over, if you see a little child with grandma. Grandma and grandpa are brooding over that little child, hovering over. And I appreciate the kind words from Pastor Shawn that I wrote down for him to say about me. It's hard to preach when you start crying. I start out crying, so. But listen to this. God was brooding, hovering over the face of the waters, right? Over what? Darkness. Over the abyss, over confusion, over the deep. I'm just going to leave that with you because we're talking about the word mystery. And so, not Nancy Drew, not the Hardy Boys, not Murder, She Wrote, all that stuff. Those are mystery that can't, it's unsolved crime or unsolved situation. Mystery in the Bible is completely different. All right? I look at Joel, he's a mystery. How much he loves people, how much he enjoys life, how much he just is so steady in life, he's a mystery. I look at Pastor Shawn, and how can a young man be so gifted, so blessed, and I appreciate his friendship more than you know. And he's a mystery too, so, in a good way. All right, so let's go to the first third verse where we really get into this word. And God saw... No, verse 3 it says, and God said, this is the great word of God, God spoke finally through this. When God's word comes out, then we've got something going on. He was hovering over this thing, the darkness, but what did he do? Changed it up. God said, let there be light. That was the first word spoken from the mouth of God that we know of. Let there be light, what happened? Now notice, the Spirit moved, but activity didn't place until the word came. Yeah. We can have a wonderful time of worship together and a time of great growth in the Lord from being in the presence, like Brother Tony said, but when the word comes, something happens. Amen. It's the word of God that's quick and powerful and sharper than anything in life that the word says. So, I am going to say this. The verse 4 said, God saw the light. It was good, suitable, pleasant, and he approved it. The Amplified says, and God separated, listen to this, this is before the sun was created, is that right? Yes. There was no sunshine, but here's light. Now another thing they've studied for thousands of years is light. Ever heard of Dr. Einstein?
Yeah.
Theory of something? I'm not a scientist, I'm just a lowly Bible man. Light came before the sun was created. If we turned all the lights out in here, would we have darkness?
Yes.
That's not the type of darkness that was here in Genesis. It wasn't just you couldn't see. It was the type of darkness that Hebrew calls the abyss. It was the type of darkness that the Israelites saw come on Egypt when it was gross darkness. And I don't want to go there. Part of the judgment in the judgments of God is darkness. How many have ever studied the black holes of the universe? Anybody? I have. That's a scary thing. If you go down that black hole, you don't know where you're going. You don't know how, where you end up. They don't know. It's a mystery. So, God saw the light was good, suitable, pleasant, and he approved it, and God separated light from darkness. Remember that as we go through this idea of the mystery of the faith. My verse, 1 Timothy 3:9. Now, we have to ask these questions. What is the significance of waste, void, darkness in deep water? I had to ask this. I've studied these verses out for years, like many people have. I've come to conclusions, but I'm not sure I'm right, because it's a mystery. So what is the significance of waste, void, darkness, and deep water? Well, I think we know from the Bible it means, signifies disaster and judgment. These are all negative things. Then all of a sudden, a bell rang. Something good happened, right? Something good is, specifically, the Spirit of God and the Word were spoken, let there be light, and there was light. Now listen to this. We could talk about this verse for, like scholars have for years, but we don't. This is not my message. I want to say this. The Bible does talk about this in several verses. Ever read Job in 38 when God comes to Job and says, what are you talking about, boy? He said, you listen to me. Were you there? And he gave him a science lesson on everything he created. Were you there when No, I wasn't there, sir. He said, were you there when I laid the foundations of the planet? Remember reading that? Were you there when all the sons of God sang for joy? Well, who are the sons of God? The angelic host. They were there for the creation of the world. They were there pre-creation, pre-Adamic, we'll call it. So in a vision, in Jeremiah 4:23, in a vision, Jeremiah sees Judah laid waste by conquest and captivity, Babylon. But this is what Jeremiah said in 4:23 of Jeremiah. I looked at the land, and behold, it was at the same as the same time of creation. It was just like at the same time of creation. Waste, vacant, and void, and the heavens had no light. All right, I'm just setting a backdrop for you because God has shrouded himself in mystery. And this is one of them. Now, are mysteries spoken of in the Bible? I've got your attention, don't I? You're really, I love a mystery. Well, good, because we're going to see mysteries unfold today. And the mystery of godliness and the mystery of other things are my ideas today. The mystery, are mysteries spoken of in the Bible? We have to say yes, because life has three big questions. I had to do this when I was 4 years old when my grandfather died. And I couldn't understand what happens, you know, when you die. But the three biggest questions in life are, where do we come from? Why does evil exist? Where do we come from? Why does evil exist? And did God create the universe? Well, if you're a believer, you know these things, don't you? So the mysteries are solved already for us. Where did we come from? God. Well, your mommy's belly. Your mama, I came from my mama. But you came from God. How about the mystery of a microscopic cell becoming a human being with eyes, with millions of cells making the eyes work, and the heart? I read an article once says the heart pumps enough blood in 1 year to fill, I think it was 5 747 jumbo jets. I might be wrong on it. Maybe it was 3. Maybe it was 10. I don't know. It was a lot of blood your heart pumps. Now, I was in the business of pumps and irrigation for years, and I kept going. I asked the doctor one time, I said, how does this thing keep pumping? Boom, 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 boom. And there's no battery. There's no electricity. If you unplug this electricity, we'd all be without the power. Who gives you? Have you ever asked these things? It's a mystery. Doctor did. It wasn't Dr. Sunny, though. He knows a lot. So, I want to say that the Bible definition of mystery, and if you're taking notes, this is really interesting. The Bible word for mystery is a Greek word called mysterion, something like that. But it's just like mystery. I want you to hear what the Bible defines as the mystery. Totally different than the Webster's. Okay? So this makes it a lot more fun because we're Bible people, right? Mm-hmm. Mystery is a hidden or secret thing not obvious to the understanding. Any hidden mystery, it is not something unknowable or unsolvable. Isn't that great? The mysteries of God are not unknowable or unsolvable. Rather, what can only be known by revelation by God himself. Whew. How many have had revelations from this? You read in the Bible, and then also, boy, the light goes on. Amen. Remember the story of the two disciples that were on the road to Emmaus? Yeah. And when they got with Jesus, they were walking along. Hey, did you hear about that guy? There was a guy down in Jerusalem. He was, he called himself the Son of God. They were walking. Did you hear about that guy? Jesus somehow made himself a little bit more, what's the Bible say? He was kind of not... They couldn't recognize him. And he said, well, did you hear about that guy in Jerusalem? He said he was the Son of God. And then all of a sudden, Jesus opens up the scriptures to them. He said, did not our heart burn within us when we talked about the way? And when he opened up the scriptures, our eyes were opened. Remember that? Remember, the scriptures will open your eyes.
Amen.
Jesus said, have you not read? So, the nether definition, this is a better definition. It's not something unknowable or unsolvable, but rather what only can be known by revelation from God himself. A better definition, also in Greek, is a secret, the counsels of God, once hidden, but now revealed in the gospel. Is that all right? Yeah. The secret counsels of God, once hidden, but now revealed in the gospel. Isn't that exciting?
Yes.
So all of you are secret private eye detectives. You are revealing mysteries. And you should be looking for the mysteries of God. Not just going to church and having fun, which I like to do. By the way, this fellowship together is what God wants. Fellowship.
Yes.
You know, I can go to an Italian club. The Sons of Italy, where my grandma and grandpa were part of the Italian group way back in the 30s. And that's a lot of fun, having pasta and having the old ladies pinch my cheek. Oh, really? Hey, mamma mia. That's a lot of fun. But it's not fellowship. The word fellowship is koinonia.
That's right.
That means the fellowship of the Holy Ghost is with God, with me, with my wife, with Pastor Shawn, with John, everybody in fellowship with him.
Amen.
That's what fellowship is. It's not a coffee cup. It's the Spirit of God.
Amen.
Working in you to enjoy each other. How can we have fellowship without the love of God? I mean, Pastor Bishop was a great, great blessing to me, and that was a great part of our heritage, and he would sure be awful proud of you guys today, especially you.
Amen.
See this thing going.
Glory.
Where was I? Fellowship. Italian club. Anyway, let's get back to this. A better definition is this. The counsels of God, once hidden, but now revealed in the gospel. God only comprehends the unfathomable mysteries of the universe, and the content of divine mystery is painted in broad strokes throughout the Bible. But, listen to this. The biblical concept of the divine mystery, which I said, God has shrouded himself in mystery. Has anybody ever seen God? The Bible says no. Has God been revealed? Yes.
Yeah.
Have you ever seen in the morning when the little bird comes up? I've got quails that go through our yard. And that mama quail herding the little quail. God's in that little quail. And then some of the flowers that I see growing in Yakima on the trees. God's in every breath, every waterfall, every breeze. God feels all in all. He's in everything. Psalmist said that if I make my bed in hell, thou art there.
Yes.
His wrath is there. God's everywhere. So this definition, divine mystery emphasizes God's sovereignty. God is sovereign. In the New Testament biblical understanding of the divine ministry, God's emphasis is grace.
Amen.
Amen. Jesus Christ came in grace only?
No. True.
I like that part too. Grace and truth. You can have a lot of grace, but if you're not in the truth, wash it.
Amen.
You got to walk in the truth. So anyway, I want to say this. There are a few scriptures I'm going to use today. We'll go to the first one, I think, is the next verse there. There's a few scriptures, there's actually 22 total, that just use the word mystery in the New Testament. And I want to show these to you, and then we'll get to the heart of what I want to tell you. Number one is in Ephesians. It says, having made known unto us the mystery of his will. Isn't that a beautiful one? He's made known to you, what is God's will for me? It's a mystery, but he's made it known to you according to the good pleasure which he has purposed in himself. How do you find God's will? Simple. He's already purposed for you to know his will. And another verse is the Ephesians 6:19. As for me, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel. Here's another mystery, the mystery of the gospel. Why is it mysterious? You know why. It says because Satan has blinded people's eyes. And it's a mystery to them. I didn't really understand the gospel till the Lord came to me and brought me into understanding by the Holy Spirit. Went, wow, I can see this. And you did too. Even my wife was raised in a pastor's home. One day the Lord just revealed himself by the Spirit and opened her eyes to know the grace of God in Jesus Christ as Savior. Yeah. How old were you, honey?
About 10.
All right. Well, I was 20, so I was a little late on that. So, anyway, the next one I want to say is the third, which is a huge, beautiful scripture here to talk about, but I won't talk about it. In Ephesians 5:22, it says, this is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. In this chapter, he's talking about husband and wife. Relationships, right? Then there he is. I know you think I'm talking about husband and wife relationships, but I'm talking about Christ and the church. Oh, that's a mystery. And then another one is the great mystery of Christ, whereby when you read, you may understand my knowledge and the mystery of Christ. Another one is the revelation. The mystery of the seven stars. Revelation is written in mystery form. Much of the Bible is written in mystery form. Why? So you'll dig it out. So you pour your heart into it. So you'll reach into it. You'll search for it like fine gold. So 22 times this has been in the history. But there's another mystery I was thinking about the other day. I think one of the messages that was here was a week or two ago was on prophecy. Prophecy, covenant to prophesy. And he that speaks in tongues is edifying himself. He that prophesies edifies others. So it's much better to edify others. But listen to this. In the 14:1 of Corinthians it says, he that speaks in an unknown tongue edifies himself. Verse 1 says, howbeit in the spirit he speaks
mystery.
Isn't that cool? Well, I don't know if it's cool, but it's mystery. So here we go. Prophesy, but when you, Aaron Baxter used to teach, tongues is the best builder-upper you have. I believe that. We need to pray in the spirit. Pray in the Holy Spirit because we're speaking mysteries to God. Just threw that in for just your thoughts. So, but this is a verse in the gospel. This is what Jesus said. I want to say this. Jesus said this to give us clear understanding of who we are, where we're going, and what's going on. The next one says, Jesus, to you, Jesus said, you have been entrusted the mystery of the kingdom of God. That is the secret counsels of God, which have been hidden from the ungodly, but for those outside of our circle, everything becomes a parable. That one on there too? Yeah. To you, listen now, you've been given to, entrusted with the mystery of the kingdom of God. That is, the secret counsels of God, which were hidden from the ungodly. So you have a a total different understanding now of how God shrouds himself in mystery, but you have been given the ability to understand some of these things. Not all of it. You'll never understand all the verses that have some deep, deep meanings to it. Some verses we just don't fully understand. David actually said, these things are too high for me. I can't attain it. And he was a prophet. So I want to get to the heart of the message. The most Bible teachers refer to two primary mystery verses in Scripture. The number one is the mystery of iniquity. Okay? The number one mystery that Bible teachers like to take and dismantle is called the mystery of iniquity. And we've talked a little bit about it when we read Genesis chapter 1, 1 through 4, because that's a mystery of the satanic fall. God created cherubim, seraphim, teraphim, an angelic archangel order, of which, if you read Scripture, you'll see in Isaiah and then in Ezekiel, that there was an anointed cherub that covered. Some people think he had a throne, according to some of the Scriptures. So he was a high-ranking, the highest-ranking angel. Said that he had music was actually built within his person. These are all mysteries, too. I don't spend a lot of time studying Lucifer. I don't do it. But you need to know some of these things because we need to understand that the mystery of iniquity is something that is defined by what happens in the person who's living in iniquity. And this is where it started. The definition of this is, has a person that lives in iniquity has a strong determination to reject the will and laws of God. That's what iniquity means. Rebellion. And in that sense, it is lawless without respect for divine authority. Now, we will never know as believers what happened on that day when it says, because of his exceeding beauty, because he was so beautiful, his heart was filled with pride, and he said, I will be like the Most High. I don't understand that. I always bow down when I think of God. I don't know what he was thinking, but that's what happened. Now, another thing we need to say is that the Bible translations translate the King James word iniquity, the new Bible translation, as lawless, because the Greek word anomia means without law. So when we take the text for the mystery of iniquity, just in 2 Thessalonians, says, the mystery of iniquity that produces end-time apostasy is a strong spirit of rebellion against the laws of God. You can refer to 2 Thessalonians. It's actually referring to the Antichrist, the system that's coming, all that, and I don't understand that at all. Now, the other thing that is the great primary mystery verse is more blessed to read than the other. The mystery of godliness. And this is one of my favorite verses in the Bible because it shows the six characteristic mysteries of God in Christ. And it goes like this. 1 Timothy 3:16. Without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, and then received up into glory. That's our Jesus. That's the attributes of who he is. That's God in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, and received up into glory. Wow. This verse delineates the six elements of the mystery of Christ. And we know these mysteries, don't we? We know that he was manifest in the flesh. We know that he was received up. We know it. Now, I want to get to my main text. What time do you normally stop? 5 minutes?
3 or 4 minutes.
So, let's go to this verse that I had you in, the mystery of the faith. Let's read this together, 1 Timothy 3:9. And it goes simply like this, holding the mystery of the faith in a pure conscience. Notice that tag, holding the mystery of faith in a pure conscience. If you want to mind all the different verses on conscience, you'd realize that that's the mind, the central control system of who you are. Your spirit, your heart, but your mind is where you renewed, where you regenerated, and where you make decisions. So pure conscience, the conscience is the mind. So, but the holding of the mystery of the faith, I would like to read this translation to you if it's up there. It really means this. This is the best translation I could find to convey the truth of this. Upholding and fully understanding the mystery, that is, the true doctrine of the Christian faith, with a clear conscience resulting from behavior consistent with spiritual maturity. Is that up there? That is so good. And this is the life and the lifestyle of people of faith. Upholding and fully understanding the mystery, that the true doctrine of the Christian faith, with a clear conscience resulting from behavior consistent with spiritual maturity. Now I want to make a couple comments here, because I said that this type, when we talk about, some of your Bibles are going to have the mystery of faith. But it clearly says in the original text, mystery of the faith. When Jude talks about his contention for contending for the faith once delivered to the saints, he's not saying mystery for faith once delivered. The faith. What is the faith versus faith? Well, I'll tell you. It is a term that means the essential truths of the gospel that all true Christians hold in common. What are the truths that we have? It's the Word. Amen. Yeah. I'm not going to go left or right of this, and you shouldn't either.
Right.
Well, the Spirit told me to go.
Nope.
I remember one time in the early charismatic movement, Bob Mumford was teaching about the Spirit, people hearing the Spirit tell them what to do. Spirit tells me to do stuff every day. Especially when I lose something. Lord, help me find that washer I dropped. But he was driving down the street in the sport. Spirit of the Lord told Bob Mumford, take a left right here. Take another left. Go preach to the lady in the third house on this block. Well, there's no houses on the block. So he went back home and said, well, Lord, I must not have heard right. I used to try to pray every time there was a hitchhiker. Am I supposed to pick this guy up? Did you guys do that too? And I remember the days when we were talking about great, great wonders of God. And the thing about the faith versus the faith is we can have faith to do all kinds of things. But when we talk about the faith, it's about who you are, what you're like. The Greek scholar Rick Renner says, it does not refer to raw faith, such as faith for miracles, signs, and wonders. The word faith used in this context is to denote the teaching of sound doctrine of Scripture, but rather the life of faith, the sum total of Christian belief, and all the fundamental truths once delivered by God, that remain unburied forever. What keeps us all on the same page? What keeps us all connected here? Is it Jesus? Yeah. But it's the Word. It's the game plan. It's the blueprint. It's all the words that are His and given to Paul, and all these words. This is what it is, walking in the faith. So, I want to take another side trip here. In this passage of 1 Timothy 3:9, it really refers to the lifestyle requirements for elders and deacons, if we go into context. If we start in verse chapter 3, I might read a couple. We have a couple minutes. I'll read a couple verses there. Let's do that real quick. Do I have time for 5 minutes? Yes. I'm older than him. I can do anything I want. I'm kidding. No, he's a pastor. I'm submitted. I'm a submitted man. I love you, man.
I'm married too.
That's the thing. Here's a good mystery. Here's a good mystery one for you. I've been married 43 years, and we built a couple churches together. We've had three wonderful children together, and a daughter in heaven, and grandchildren, and we built a business, and we did all these things together, and I'm a strong alpha male, right? And the mystery is that she is smarter, she is more equipped, she knows the Bible better, she can pray and gather people, and she does math 10 times better than I ever could, and I'm the head of the house. That's a mystery. Another mystery is the day that I heard about this years ago was one day, people don't know this, and I hope you don't mind me telling this story. It's funny. One day, Shawn didn't want to get up in the morning, and he heard this voice, Shawn, Johnny, time to get up and go to church. He says, I don't want to go to church today. Shawn, get up, time to go to church. I'm not getting up and going to church today. Well, you give me two good reasons why you're not getting out of that bed. Get out of bed and go to church. He said, well, two reasons are this. I don't like the people, and the people don't like me. So anyway, then he heard another voice. You get up, Shawn, and get out of that bed. And I'm going to give you two reasons why you're going to church. Number one, you're 31 years old. And number two, you're the pastor. That's a joke. All right, let's get serious here again, because we'll get you laughing so I can punch you in the teeth without cracking your lip. This is really interesting here now. Verse 1 of chapter 3, I'm just going to read carefully, and I want to get to that verse. It says, this is a true saying, irrefutable. If a man desires and seeks the office of a bishop, superintendent, overseer, he desires an excellent task or work. This is an elder in the church. Now, bishop, superintendent, overseer must have no grounds for accusation. They must be above reproach, husband of one wife, circumspect, temperate, self-controlled. Must be sensible and well-behaved, dignified, and lead an orderly, disciplined life. He must be hospitable, showing love for those, becoming a friend for the believers, especially strangers and foreigners, and be capable and qualified to teach. Not given to wine, not combative, but gentle and considerate, not quarrelsome, forbearing, peaceable, not a lover of money, have an insatiable desire for wealth to retain and obtain it by questionable means. It means you need to handle money well. He must rule his own household well, keeping his children under control. That's a tough one.
That's a mystery.
They're giving shots for that now, I heard. But anyway. He should keep his children under control with true dignity, commanding their respect in every way, and keeping them respectful. For if a man does not know how to rule his own household, how can he take care of the church of God? Okay? He must not be a new convert, or he may develop a beclouded, stupid state of mind and result in pride, being blinded by conceit and fall into the condemnation of the devil. Interesting, the devil's here now again? Yeah, pride, condemnation. If a man's proud or a woman's proud, you don't want to have them in leadership. Furthermore, he must be of good reputation and be well thought of by the community outside the church, lest he be involved in slander and incur reproach and fall into the devil's trap. Twice in two verses, the devil's mentioned. This is leaders now I'm talking about. In the like manner, and here we go, this verse that I'm trying to get to. In like manner, deacons, and this word could be translated servants in the church, the word servant, must be worthy of respect, not shifty, double talkers, but sincere, and what they say, not given to too much wine, not greedy for base gain, craving wealth, and resorting to ignoble and dishonest methods of getting it. Now here's the verse I'm looking at, our text. They must possess the mystic secret of the Christian faith, the truth, as hidden from ungodly men with a clear conscience. And let them also be first tried and investigated and proved first. If they turn out to be above reproach, let them see, serve as deacon. Now this is pretty heavy stuff. What I'm saying here is that the mystery of holding the faith, is that you were once unready. You were once a thief. You were once unbelievably gone away from God. You were once doing things with people that God condemns in Scripture and you didn't even know it. You were once an angry person at people. You were once a thief, or you could have committed crimes that we don't even know about. And the mystery of faith is God transformed you by the power of Jesus Christ. His name came into you and he transformed you. Yes. That's the mystery of faith. Why can this deacon be above reproach? Why can this elder be circumspect, having their children in order? I think my household was out of order a lot. You know, we kept going, trying to fix it. I had one boy, he had a temper like Albert Mussolini. I would discipline him. We finally found, this is not working. The paddles got bigger, and he got more wild. And, you know, Daniel, he kicked every door in our hallway in with fury. Come, what? Ah! Like that. He wasn't trying karate. He was just furious with his temper. My house was out of order, and I was a pastor. So what do? You fix it. So what am I saying? This mystery, holding to the mystery of faith, we're actually trustees of God. I was taught when Ern Baxter spoke into my life, he said, when you open the Bible before people, you're handling God. You don't have the right to preach yourself. You're not preaching yourself, you're preaching Christ. You are literally handling God. It's the Holy of Holies when you come to this. So why does a person need to take heed to all these things? Because you have been changed into his likeness and image. Now, an image is different than a likeness. Can I say this real quick? And then I'm going to stop. Because when we are in his image, I can show you an image of Asher Niles. And that image is just fantastic, isn't it? He's one of the cutest guys I've ever seen. And but the image is like the image on a coin. That's George Washington. Are we in the likeness of George Washington? Because we have an image in our... The image of God, we're created in the image of God. When God created man, when he incarnated himself, God chose the human body in Jesus Christ. He's the firstborn among many brethren, it says. Brothers. I don't call him brother, I call him Lord, but... We are like God in the sense we're created in his image. But the likeness is behavioral. Are you like Christ in your behavior? Are you like Christ when it says the deacon? And I think when you use the word deacon, that means servant. I think all of us are deacons. Amen. You don't see them ordained as much anymore. But we are all servants of the Most High God. And so that gives me the ability to say to you from 1 Timothy that we must be including all these attributes of godly living. Now, I'll say this one thing too. Back in the 70s, before I met Priscilla, I was so thrilled with the conferences in the charismatic movement. We had Bob Mumford and Charles Simpson and John Poole and ministers from all over the world, England and everything. And it was just an awesome movement, the charismatic movement. And I went to every conference this month. I went to another conference this month. And I went to another conference. There were signs and wonders. We prayed for bullfrogs to get healed. We prayed for Volkswagens, for demons to come out of my Volkswagen bus. Woohoo! out and tried walking on water. I don't laugh, I did. I didn't walk on water, I tried it. So, but anyway, we were fired up. And so what happened was, we went to a conference one year, and Charles Simpson, one of my favorite teachers, he's still alive. He said, brethren, he's got a nice Dallas, Texas, Southern girl. He said, brethren, he said, tonight I feel led to talk to you about the home. What the home? What's that got to do with anything? The Christian home is something we really need to focus on, I believe, in this movement. I went, the home? My home was a mess. My dad was an alcoholic. I don't want to talk about the home. I'm going to talk about demons coming out of Volkswagens. I want to talk about things. I remember praying for my wife. I said, Lord, is she the one I'm to marry? Give me a sign. Went way up on the roof of the flour mill in Seattle. 4 o'clock in the morning, I'm praying, Lord, is she the one I'm supposed to marry? I need a sign. And I saw a shooting star. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Yeah. Went up the next time. I said, I need one more sign. And nothing happened in the sky. But then I heard two seagulls squawk. Wah, wah, wah. Thank you, Jesus. That's it. She's the one. Actually, the reality is I lucked out. She was already. Anyway, what's this all mean? Charles Simpson talking about the home went right past me. You remember these things, Roger? We'd go to conference just to be there in the atmosphere. Oh. And so what it was saying to me is time to grow up. Time to be a man of God. Time to be a husband. Time to be a wife. Time to be with your children. These are all things that represent the likeness and image of Christ. Say amen.
Amen.
Well, who you are and what you are and what you do is a representation of the mysteries of Christ.
Amen.
Let this be the last scripture we'll do. This says in 1 Corinthians 4:1, if you're taking notes, it says this. Let a man so account of us as the ministers of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. We are stewards. We're not just ministers. Every one of you has a ministry to do. This church is all about ministry and outgoing. Going out. But you're all stewards. You're all ministers. You are stewards of the mysteries of God. All the mysteries of God. You are handling them. A better translation says this. We are the servants of Christ and trustees of the mysteries. Secret purposes of God. I'm going to say this as I close, that right now, there's going to be some more secret purposes from God coming your way.
Oh, yeah.
Starting today, starting this month. God has a destiny for this church, and there's a sure sense in God that we're not not going to see a stop. This room right here is big enough for your music team. That's it.
Right.
You got me? This room is just big enough for your music team. God is going to explode into you. But remember to hold to these things. You are stewards, trustees of the secret purposes of God. Mysteries.
Thanks for watching this message from Dad's House Church in Yakima, Washington. Be sure to check out dadshousechurch.org for other videos and more exciting information.